Talhah ibn Ubaidullah was born approximately 15 years before the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a man, as a young boy he grew up and he was extremely intelligent, from the noblemen of Quraysh, a beautiful family. Remember those who said that only the weak and downtrodden were accepting Islam are wrong. All these names we are hearing, they were people who were noblemen in Quraysh. They came from top families, they were wealthy people, they were highly looked up to by Quraysh and the people of Quraysh. So Talha, as a young man, he used to go to the various regions or parts of the Arabian Peninsula for business. And one day he arrived in Asham, the northern part of the Arabian Peninsula, a place known as Busra. And he was with his caravan and with Quraysh, and they spent quite a bit of time there. And surprisingly, he heard one of the monks, one of the Christian monks, calling out, saying, "Those who have come from Mecca, is there anyone from the Haram itself? Is there anyone from amongst you who have come to do business from the Haram?" And Talha ibn Ubaidullah, as young as he was, he responded to this monk and he said, "You know what? Yes, I am one of them." He said, "I am one of them." So the monk says, "I have heard that at that particular place right now is the time for a prophet to come." Subhanallah. "So has this prophet come?" So Talha says, "I'm not sure." He says, "His name is Ahmad." Now Ahmad, as you know, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called him the same name in the Quran. So what has happened? Subhanallah. He said, "What is his full name?" This man says, "He is the son of Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib." Talha ibn Ubaidullah was shocked. He was surprised. He was amazed. And this monk had actually said, "He has come out in Mecca right now. And my little son, or you young man, do not let others beat you to him," meaning don't let them overtake you to accepting him. He is a truthful messenger. So Talha ibn Ubaidullah says, "As crucial as the business deals were, and as much as I wanted to make money, I decided to gather my camels and to start going back to Mecca." He says, "Very soon I arrived in Mecca." He was only a teenager. He arrived in Mecca to al-Mukarramah, and the first person he went to was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, because they were related somehow. And at the same time, he chose to go to Abu Bakr because he knew Abu Bakr as a very good man. Abu Bakr was intelligent. He was a person who was easy to talk to. He was a very upright businessman. Everyone knew him as honest and he never lied. So he asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He says, "Oh Abu Bakr, have you heard of this?" So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu told him, "Yes indeed, I've heard about it. And yes indeed, I have followed him." Subhanallah. Now just prior to him asking Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when he arrived in Mecca and he met his family, he asked them a question. "Has something big happened in Mecca whilst I was away?" They told him, "Yes, that Muhammad ibn Abdullah has turned away from the religion of his forefathers. And that Muhammad ibn Abdullah is now claiming to be a person whom revelation comes to. And he says you should worship your creator alone and forget about all these idols." So immediately Talha ibn Ubaidullah went to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and the discussion occurred. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu told him, "I have followed him." So Talha was shocked. He was surprised. He says, "You know what? I want to tell you what happened when I went to Busra in Asham. Whilst I was on a business trip, one of the monks gave me this news." So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was so delighted. He said, "Let's go to Muhammad and let's tell him what you are saying." So Talha knew Ibn Ubaidullah in his heart that this has to be the truth, because Muhammad is known as a Sadiqul Amin, the most truthful, the honest from amongst us. He cannot be now at the age of 40 lying to us when we've never ever known him to have lied a single lie regarding any one of us. Why would he lie about the Maker himself? So it was amazing that Talha ibn Ubaidullah, Allah put it in his heart. He went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad ibn Abdullah told him, "Oh Talha, I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I call you to discard and leave the religion of your forefathers, which is the worshipping of idols and the evil culture which oppresses women and which usurps the wealth of the stranger and so on. Quit all that and turn to Allah and Allah alone. Talha ibn Ubaidullah immediately accepted the message. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I bear witness that you are indeed the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None worthy of worship besides our maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was approximately the 8th person to accept Islam. Young boy, meaning in his teenage. Talha ibn Ubaidullah, sharp business person from his teen years. Amazing. So he got back to Makkah subhanallah and he told his people that he had accepted Islam. No sooner had they heard that he accepted Islam than they tried to harm him and they started to harm him. He had a relative of his known as, in fact, his own mother. Her name was As-Sa'bah bint al-Hadrami. She was a very difficult woman. You know, the name is As-Sa'bah. Sa'bah in the Arabic language means one who is difficult. Now I want to pause there for a moment and encourage us all. When we are naming our children or our relatives, we should use good names. The name is so difficult itself. Imagine someone names you a difficult person. What do you expect to be thereafter? So this woman was called As-Sa'bah, the difficult one. She was hoping that Talha would be from amongst the leaders of Quraysh because he was intelligent and he was wealthy at a young age. So she had a lot of hope. But when he accepted Islam, she was so angry and so upset that she began not only to swear him and to use abusive words against him, but she told others to beat him up. So from amongst them was Nawfal ibn Khuwaylid. Nawfal ibn Khuwaylid was the brother of Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha. He troubled Talha ibn Ubaidullah and a few of the early Muslims a lot. They were young, in his teen years. And so Nawfal tied him up, took with him Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. They tied the two of them up and they took them to a certain place just on the outskirts of Makkah. And they made sure that all the youngsters happened to swear them, mock at them, throw things at them, and they beat them up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. In fact, this Talha ibn Ubaidullah was harmed so much, they tied his hands behind his neck and they took him, pulled him, dragging him in a large group of people towards the Mount of Safa. And they started throwing stones at him and beating him and telling him that you'd better leave the religion of Muhammad. How dare you follow this faith? But he was so strong. He had heard in Busra what the monk had to say. And more than that, he was convinced by the message. All Muhammad is saying is, worship your maker and your maker alone. Don't worship anything else. Turn to your maker. So he was convinced that this is correct. And he kept on sticking to his beliefs and they kept on harming him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us all. He had heard also Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read verses of the Quran which had touched his heart. Talha ibn Ubaidullah was a person who stuck to his faith. And in fact, if we take a look at what happened later on when they were in the Battle of Uhud, Talha ibn Ubaidullah was known for his bravery in the Battle of Uhud. So much so that, do you know, whenever Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu spoke about the Battle of Uhud, he said that was the battle of Talha ibn Ubaidullah. He was the hero of Uhud. Now, why do they know him as the hero of Uhud? Let me explain to you. Let's quickly go to the Battle of Uhud, where, you know, initially the Muslimin were winning. And then when the archers decided to come down from the mount and disobey the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the disbelievers of Makkah happened to come back and attack, and they swiped the Muslimin in a way that many people had suffered, so much so that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's teeth were martyred, and at the same time he had a gash on his lip and a gash on his forehead sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was lying down in Uhud. He was sitting down at one place where the mount, or in one of the parts of the mount. And a whole group of enemies had come to attack him. And around him were a few of the Ansar and Talha ibn Ubaidullah. Very few men. And there were so many mushrikeen who had come. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked his companions, who would take care of these mushrikeen? So Talha said, I will. He said, no, you sit down. So the Ansar one by one went, and each one of them were martyred, until there was only Talha and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remaining. And a group of the mushrikeen started coming very close. Talha ibn Ubaidullah got up, and he really fought these people so much, he did not allow them to get close to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say he suffered more than 70 wounds on his body, protecting Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he chased away those mushrikeen in a battle that was just between him and a whole group of mushrikeen on the day of Uhud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguarded him and safeguarded Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On that day, he lost his palm. The palm of one of his hands was martyred as well on that particular day. He lost it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him goodness. So much so that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu and Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu anhu, they happened to rush towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when they saw him in blood. And they asked him, O messenger, are you okay? He said, don't worry about me. Go and see your companion Talha ibn Ubaidullah. He was laying on the floor in a pool of blood with so many gashes that he had. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness and a lesson to learn from this. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to call him Ash-Shaheedul Hayy, the martyr who is alive. Allahu Akbar. And he was the one whom the day of Uhud belonged to, according to a lot of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this was the man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, Talha, you are from amongst those who have already earned paradise. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Look at him. So what he lost, listen to this carefully, what he lost in terms of his business deals when he had just accepted Islam, and what he lost in terms of the respect amongst the disbelievers of Quraysh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much in return. It was multiplied so much. And he had such a big heart. He was one of those just like Uthman ibn Affan. Some say that he was even more generous because he gave a lot. Like we said, quantity wise, no one competes with Uthman. But when you look at percentage wise, there were a lot who actually had given so much. Even what they would have for themselves, they would give it away to others. One of those was Talha ibn Ubaidullah. Let me give you an example. One of the days, this man, one of his caravans had just come in from Hadramaut in the evening, and he had stock worth 700,000 dirhams. Stock worth 700,000 dirhams. And in the evening he was worried, and he was sitting on his bed and he could not sleep. So his wife, who was the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, by the name of Kulthum bint Abi Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anha, she told him, oh my beloved husband, have I done something to hurt you? You are looking quite worried today. So he looked at her and said, you are such a great woman. You see me concerned and you actually think that you are the one who has made me worried? Imagine when our wives sometimes see us worried, I wonder if they would actually come to us and tell us, is it me who's done something to you? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us husbands who are concerned even of their own wives. When we see them worried, it is important for us to ask them, I hope it's nothing I have done that has made you so worried. We learn it from here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us the best of spouses. Ameen. So, and may Allah bless those who are not married with spouses who will be the coolness of their eyes. Oh, look at that loud ameen, mashallah. May Allah grant it to us all, ameen. So this was the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So she looked at him, he said, not at all. She says, well then I think I know what is bothering you. You have so much wealth here in your home. So much wealth here in your home, subhanallah. And you are perhaps worried, what are you going to answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when there are people outside who are poor and who are beggars? He said, yes, exactly. So she said, why don't you just distribute this wealth? He said, no problem. They started making little packs. They started making portions. And in the morning, they called out there in Madinah Munawwara, and they gave out all that to those who were poor amongst the Muslimin in Makkah, in Madinah Munawwara. 700,000 silver coins worth of stock, everything given. This was the man, Talha ibn Ubaidullah. He was also a man whom once someone came to him who was needy and told him, do you know what, O Talha, you are a person who looks after all your relatives, because he made sure that everyone from his relation and his family were all taken care of. He was a person who used to look after the whole of Banu Taym. Anyone from Banu Taym, poor, Talha ibn Ubaidullah would spend on them and he would provide for them food and whatever else they needed, them and their families. And even the others from amongst the Muslimin. So one man came to him and told him, I'm related to you in this way and this way and this way and this way, and you know I need your help. So he looked at him, he says, I don't know about this relation. Nobody's told me about it before. But I offer you a piece of land that Uthman ibn Affan has offered me 300,000 for. You either take the land or I can sell it to Uthman and give you the money. He looked at Talha and he says, okay, I'll take the money. Talha ibn Ubaidullah went to Uthman, sold the piece of land, took the money and gave this person who was claiming to be a relative. This was the type of heart he had. Imagine 300,000 all at once given to one man who came to him with a story. And he was not worried. He said, Allah will provide. And guess what? The more he gave, the more he got. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us goodness. Sadly and unfortunately, he was from amongst those who was killed during the Battle of Jamal, or the Battle of the Camel, the fitna between the Muslimin. And do you know what happened? They had come out and they went to Basra, which is in Iraq, in order to meet with Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu to try and get those who had killed Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. But they did not mean to kill one another. No, not at all. And this is why it is reported in the correct narrations that Talha ibn Ubaidullah and Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, they withdrew when they saw Ali and when they spoke to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and they did not want a war. But sadly, some people killed them. So Talha ibn Ubaidullah, there are some narrations which say that Marwan ibn al-Hakam actually killed him, but the most correct of narrations say no, it was not Marwan ibn al-Hakam, it was someone else who actually killed him on that day with one spear. And when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu saw what happened, he began to weep, he cried so much, and he actually made so much of dua for Talha ibn Ubaidullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all a good lesson. Remember, I told you and I'm repeating it, be careful of those who try to instill hatred in your heart against your fellow brethren. They did this from the beginning and they succeeded in splitting the Muslimin and making them fight with one another. Up to this day, they are doing the same. Let them not succeed in this way. If we don't learn a lesson from this, why then do we go through these stories? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So Talha ibn Ubaidullah, one of the 10, and he was from amongst those whom Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu had named to be from the committee who would appoint a successor, later appointing Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu.